Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
So glad you're here. I'm Chris, one of the pastors at our church. And whether it's your first time, you've been here a lot of times, just welcome. And we're just so honored to be together and start our day off with some just amazing worship. If you're new, you have questions, or you just want to learn about how to get engaged in the life of our church, we have a place over to the right in the hospitality room. Go buy the coffee. I mean, get some coffee, then keep going. You'll see it over there when we're done. And we have people who will just answer whatever question you have, whether you're brand new or you've been here a long time. If you are new, this is one of your first times. We have a gift we'd love to give you and just get to know you a little bit. So check that out. And as always, just a reminder, your app, my app, is the way to really keep up with what's going on here at Christchurch. And love for you to open up your app, even as we're starting our time here in a second, getting into God's word. And there's sermon notes. You can check into this service, let us know you are here. That's a new feature that's really fun, and we'd love for you to do that. Does anybody get the Sunday paper still delivered to your house? Anybody? Yeah, like six of us. My daughter raised her hand. That's not true. We don't. Yeah, like. Anyway, that's distracting. Okay. Last Sunday. If you got the Daily Sun or you saw it, maybe you saw it online. This is on the front page last Sunday, and the Friday before, if you don't know what this is, it was Night to Shine, and we threw a party, and it was right here in this room. It was awesome. We had nearly 100 teenagers and adults with disabilities come and join us for a prom where they were the kings and the queens, and we had a bunch of volunteers, a bunch of people from our community partnered with us, and we just had a great time. And the Daily Sun sent their photographer over, and they wrote an article, and it was just a really cool event. And I just wanted to say thank you. You did this. You and I, we together, maybe you weren't here that night, but you're part of our church. And the reason we're able to do these things that are so, they're just a part of our heart and our mission to serve people, to serve this community of Northern Arizona, and especially those who aren't being paid attention to. And just help out the families and care workers. I mean, it was just a blast that night. And we did it because of you. You did it. When you give, when you're involved, when you're just a part of our church. But especially the financial part of this, I want to speak to for just a second. About half the people who are a part of Christ Church on a regular basis share funds with our church. They give some of their God's money that he's given them. They, you know, my family does that, many of your families, but it's about half. So what I want to tell the other half, just for a second, is we need you to be involved. We need people who maybe give a little bit here and there, or maybe haven't ever gotten involved financially, to start giving. And we've just been saying for a while, what if you just started at $100 a month? Your situation might be completely different than mine, and that's fine. You have to do it, whatever is within your, what God's given you. But for me, that's kind of the threshold when I care about something. If it's costing me about $100 a month or more, then I pay a little bit more attention. Maybe you're in a different spot, but here's the reality is if more of the folks who aren't participating don't, the next time something like this comes along, we get asked to do things quite often as a church. And right now, one of our biggest limitations is funding. And we don't want to say no to great opportunities like that. I know you don't. So we need you to help. We need you to be involved. Because we do all this together. And it's so amazing what God does with all of our small gifts. Because his economy is way different than mine. And he just uses it and he blesses our family. He'll bless every single one of us. And so I just ask you to think about it. There's ways you can do it here. But we did. We had a great time the other night. And I want to say thank you. Because you made this happen. One of the volunteers that was there that night put together this video. He was taking pictures and video. And it's just a cool celebration and recap of what we did together. So check this out.
Thank you.
be the greatest, you can be the best. You can be the King Kong banging on your chest.
You can beat the world, you can beat the war. You can talk the guy, go banging on his door.
You can throw your hands up, you can beat the clock, yeah. You can move a mountain, you can break rocks.
You can be a master, don't wait for luck. Dedicate yourself and you can find yourself.
You can run the mile, you can walk straight through hell with a smile.
You could be the hero, you could get the gold. Breaking all the records they thought never could be broke.
Yeah, do it for your people, do it for your pride. And you're never gonna know if you never even try.
Do it for your country, do it for your name.
Cause there's gonna be a day when you're
standing in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
And the world's gonna know your name.
So again, thanks for doing that. Thanks for hosting a prom Friday before last. It was a blast. And next year when we start signing up for volunteers, I expect all of you to be there, because you're just going to enjoy it. We've been in this series that ends today called One at a Time. And we're looking at interactions Jesus had in the biographies we find of him in the Bible with one person at a time, and the things that he did, and what we can learn from that. And I want to start by asking you a question. I want you to think about yourself for just a second. When were you a one? And what I mean by that, if you're like, what do you mean a one? And we've talked about this often here. So if you've been here, you know where we're going. But if you haven't caught this vernacular, it's real simple. In Luke 15, Jesus tells these stories, three stories. One of a shepherd who has 100 sheep, and one is disconnected from the flock. One is lost. And he leaves the 99 together. They're not alone. They have each other. And he goes and finds the one. And he brings the one back to the rest of the flock. And it's a picture of life, of his church and our church family, and how he intends for all of us to be connected to him and to each other. And so when we're disconnected from him, we're a one. So that's what we talk about here, this whole series, but pretty regularly. So when were you a one? I want you to think about that time in your life. Or it might have been. Now, so for some of us, we can definitely look at a time where we were separated from Jesus, from his family. But some of us, this is where I find myself more relating. As early as I can remember, my parents would take us, me and my siblings, to church. And it's always been a part, like being a part of God's family, connected to Jesus. It's just kind of always been there. And if that's where you find yourself, then I want you to think about, you were a one when you decided this was for you. It wasn't just your parents were bringing you, or your grandma, or some, like, I was born a Christian family, so I'm a Christian. Like, you went through this process at some point, maybe brief. We go, yeah, this is for me. This is for me and my family too. At our prayer time as a staff, every Thursday we get together and we have a prayer time, and one of our staff members leads a devotional. And a couple weeks ago, Amber, who's on our team, asked this question to all of us. And I was just like, I haven't thought about that in a long time. And she said, how did you feel? What happened when you were one, that when you were a little bit far from God, or really far from God? Who was involved And you coming in to a relationship with Jesus, joining his family. And she asked that question, the series of questions around, when was I a one? I just remembered very vividly being in high school. And our family had been a part of a church. It was right down the street, part of children's ministry. And we went to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Anybody grew up with that kind of a schedule? Yeah. We were at church so much they had to feed us on Wednesday nights. I remember a lot of mediocre lasagnas. And in the middle of that, middle of high school, I mean, teenager, like, you guys know what goes on there, right? You were there. My parents started going, they took us to a different church. It was in the next town over, a different school district. I mean, everything I was used to in my faith, in my life of church and being a part of this community, it was shaken. The people, the leaders, my friends, it was all mixed up. And at the exact same time, things at home were becoming more and more stressful. And right in the middle of that, at our new church, I met Todd and Anita Caldwell. When you were one, who was involved? For me, it was them. They gave me a place just to be safe. I could be myself. I found myself often more at their house than at my house. They would speak, they would talk about like what they saw in me. And they just used words that they created a world of possibilities I had never thought about, including being a pastor, going to school to study God's word. We had conversations, we ate meals together. At the time, I found myself the most confused, the most isolated. God sent two of his 99 to help me. Do you remember when you were a one? Because what struck me in that devotional of a few days ago is what Todd and Anita did, they were the same exact things we've been sharing during this series with each other as we've been talking about. How do I take what God has put in my life when I was a one and now I'm in with him and his family? How do I share that? And we've just been sharing some simple strategies, the how-tos. Things like a word. The very first week, we saw that the words we speak create worlds. And that's what I experience. That might be part of what you've experienced. And we talked about conversations. The gospel is shared person to person. Conversation with another person one at a time. Just sharing what Jesus has done in our lives. And we learned how to do that. We learned strategies. And then I don't know whose idea it was to talk about parties at church. But we did for a whole Sunday. Maybe you were there and you're like, this was the, like, what? We're talking about going to parties and hosting parties? Yes, because a party is a picture of the life God wants us to have. All of his descriptions of what heaven is like is a wedding party, a wedding banquet. They're a picture of what life is going to be like for eternity. And I'm pretty excited because I love parties. And we talked about one party at a time. And then last week, Andrew talked about meals. And we see in the Gospels over and over, and he shared the story of Jesus having a meal at Matthew's house. And these are things that God brought Todd and Anita to do in my life. And it's what we've been sharing with each other for our ones. For the people who, like me and you at one point, just need connection or reconnection. Because at one point we were all searching and we found Jesus. And some of us are here today, and you're in the middle of that search, and you need to find Jesus, and we want to help you with that. But when we're not in this place, each of us is surrounded by a one, a person who needs what we found. Because I needed what Todd and Anita had found desperately. In this series, as I've said, we're just looking at Jesus' interactions with one person at a time and just applying that to us. Let's look at one today. Luke chapter 5. Jesus was in one of the towns. A man came along who was covered with leprosy. When he saw Jesus, he fell with his face to the ground and begged him, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Oh, there's so much here to the context of the story. I want to make sure we're all kind of seeing this situation. I think the way that is accurate. See, leprosy was a disease of the skin. It still exists today. We know a whole lot more about it than they did in Jesus' time 2,000 years ago, right? Leprosy at the time was thought to be contagious. And what leprosy does is it destroys the nerve endings in a person's, first their extremities, but then throughout all of their skin. So what happens is you don't feel pain. So like that thing hot on your stove you touched recently, you wouldn't have felt that, and you would have left your hand there longer. And that would have caused it, even if you don't feel it, it still damages it, right? So leprosy is bad. And here's the thing, like, not only do your fingers actually fall off at certain points, you lose your ears, your toes. I mean, some of the leprosy's skin starts to rot over time. And this guy is covered with leprosy. He's got advanced leprosy. He's had it a while. And people with advanced leprosy smell. I'm not trying to be gross. They just smell like rotting flesh, which is a smell I try to avoid. Right? You do too. And so do the people in Jesus' day. In fact, they avoided it so much. When you started showing symptoms of leprosy in the first century, and this is actually still true in some parts of the world today, you can't live at home. Because everyone who comes in contact with you is now unclean. See, the social pain of leprosy, I think, far exceeded the physical pain of it. You couldn't live at home. If I had it today, I'd have to leave my wife and my daughter and go live out in the woods by myself. Because anybody I interacted with, anybody I got close enough to possibly or accidentally touch them or purposely touch them, now is unclean. In the time of Jesus, that meant you couldn't do the things everybody else did. You couldn't live at your house for about a week till you did all the ceremonial steps of becoming clean again. Now, you could do it, but then you wouldn't want to. So you just make sure you don't get around me. In fact, there are writings of rabbis at the time of Jesus who took pride in their ability to keep lepers away because they threw rocks at them so they wouldn't get too close. Like, that's what this person is dealing with. I don't know, maybe a decade of isolation. He was kept at arm's length. And I wonder sometimes, or I actually don't wonder, I think about, who am I keeping at arm's length? Who would I throw rocks at? Not physically. But this is what's going on. And then look what happens. Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. How do you picture this, right? Like sometimes when things, I read them in the Bible or even in other books, I almost like make it a movie, right, in my mind. You do that? Like you visualize it? When you visualize this guy with rotting flesh, missing it part or all of an ear, maybe both ears, his fingers, and I mean, he's just... There's no way he came up to Jesus close enough to be touched because he was used to people throwing rocks at him when he did. So he's back a ways. And then for Jesus to touch him, Jesus had to like go to where he was. I mean, it just had to have been that way. And I've always thought of this as he's probably on his knees and he's begging because it says he begged. And Jesus puts his hand on his shoulder, like gives him a church appropriate touch tap. you know, like we do. Maybe gave him, post-COVID, gave him knuckles. Like, hey, man. But the word touched in the language that Luke wrote this biography in, it's not a tap. It's not like a fist bump. The word's literally translated to fasten onto. So it says Jesus reached out his hand and fastened on to the man. Sometimes this word's translated cling, to cling to. It's a different picture for me when I've come to realize that. Do you think of Jesus being around someone who's unclean? Maybe being around us when we're unclean? Because what we see in this one sentence is that he hugs us. He hugged this guy who you could probably smell a mile away. I mean, think about how a hug works. Like, this, to cling on to someone, to fasten onto them. It wasn't like a two-tap bro hug. He's embracing this man. Their cheeks are touching each other, right? Because that's a real hug. And Jesus' mouth is right next to a man's rotting ear. And he says, and I like the picture that he just whispers it at first, where maybe only the guy he's hugging can hear it. He says, I am willing. Be clean. And as Jesus is hugging this man who is broken in every sense of the word, physically, spiritually, immediately the leprosy left him. Jesus, this is just what he does, right? He clings on to us as well. Now, I don't think anybody here has leprosy. It's fine if you do. But we're unclean. And I find myself spiritually rotten. And Jesus coming up to me and wrapping his arms around me and going, be clean. Haven't you experienced that? I would just say, if you haven't, you can. Because what this is the thing with Jesus. Is he gives us one act of love at a time. That is the way of Jesus. So when you look at this interaction, and it's just one of many we find in the accounts of his life and of his teaching, his actions, we just see over and over again, it's one act of love. And then another act of love to another person, to another person, to a group of people. And in church, this can be our way too. This is what God's called us to do, to help people he's put around us who need him, is just show one act of love at a time. And I want you to start to think about today, not just the person that you're one, but what is the act of love that God could use to impact them, that you could be a part of, that you could do? And I don't know what that is. I don't know who your one is. I don't know where you're at in your relationship and in the process of connecting with them. I don't know their needs or their situation. And so it kind of depends. And you're going to have to think through some of this together. Because it really just depends on where you are in this cycle. We've been talking about our approach as a church to relational evangelism, this idea that God wants me, a former one, to connect with people who are far from him and bring them into what he does. And then that they would do the same. right? And that just, and so our approach has been revolved around these three verbs that start with the letter D. So we just call it 3D1. Pretty creative. We didn't even think of that. Somebody else did. But I asked Greg, I said, hey, I think we need to visualize this. Can you put it in a picture? And Greg's really talented and he did this. So where are you? Are you developing a friendship with someone? You don't really know them, but you need, you're in the process of getting to know them. Or maybe the one that's on your mind is somebody you know, you're married to them. They're your son, they're your cousin, I mean, they're your neighbor, you've known them a long time. So you discover stories next. Get to know about them, who they are. And then you discern the next steps. What would God have you do? What is the Holy Spirit? Is it bring him to church? Is it to have a spiritual conversation? To have another meal? I don't know. But inside of this process, wherever you are in these three zones, there's an act of love that could take place. And what I want us to do is simply today is identify what could be an act of love that would impact my one, your one, wherever you are. I mean, if your one lives near you, then I would guess this winter it might involve some snow removal help. Right? No? Okay. I mean, just be helpful to people sometimes. It's just an act of love. I mean, I try to do that. I look around my neighborhood, and when I got my snowblower going, who could use help? So the biggest thing is being available. That's such a nuanced thing, but you know what I mean, right? Like, you know the people who are available in your life. And if you want to impact someone with the gospel of Jesus entering into his kingdom, then we have to be available to them, my friends. I was talking to one of my friends who's part of our church, and a couple weeks ago, right after we'd gotten, I don't even remember how many snowstorms back, right, his neighbor's driveway was iced over so bad they couldn't even park in their own driveway. They couldn't even get up their own driveway. And his was clear, and he got home from church, and he was planning on just, you know, kicking back, relaxing the rest of that Sunday. And he realized his neighbor is his one. And not just to be helpful, but just to develop a little bit more friendship. He and his wife went over and helped his neighbor and his neighbor's wife for several hours work on this ice snow situation. Be available. It could be going to lunch with someone, inviting someone, accepting an invitation. Someday in the future, going on a hike together. Whatever it is that will help your friendship or help you discover stories or feels like the next step God's putting on your heart. Acts of love. Just give you a warning. If you decide you're going to do these things, acts of love are almost always interruptions. They were for Jesus. Jesus wasn't going to look for people with leprosy to hug. He was in the middle of something else. He got interrupted. They are for me often. I mean, some of it can be very intentional on my part, but it's often, am I just available to an interruption? Here's some other ideas. Is your neighbor a young parent? They don't know Jesus, they're not connected to his family? Well, make them your one and start helping them with their kids. Help somebody with things around their house. Or maybe you're a parent with young kids. And there's some older people live on your street whose family, they're not near their family, and they're definitely not connected to what Jesus is about. Well, let your kids find some new adopted grandparents. They'll love it eventually. Right? Like what could just be an act of love? Another friend was telling me recently about on his day off, he starts this conversation with his neighbor, who's his one? And his neighbor, he can tell really wants, this conversation is not going to be quick. And he initially just wanted it to be quick so he could get back to the things he was doing. And And he just sensed maybe it was time to just be in the moment, be available. And the conversation did take a little while. And at the end of it, his neighbor said, "Hey, will you pray for my relative who's ill?" And it was the first time that his one had brought up anything spiritual at all in their conversations. And he was just available to genuinely care for people. Think about where you work. When was the last time you looked around your work and said, "Hey, how can I help everybody else out?" Or is it always like, "How do I get my part done, make the boss think I'm doing awesome?" And maybe you're the boss. Like, how do you look at the people that are your responsibility as places to serve, not people to manage? Help someone at your work with a project or solve a problem. Let them take the credit for it. That'd be awesome. See, helping others succeed, that's not the norm anymore, is it? It definitely doesn't feel like it in our culture. But it should be the norm for us as the followers of Jesus. I love the wisdom we find in the Old Testament in a book called Proverbs. It's this gathering of writings and proverbs, like the name suggests. A lot of people who say the Old Testament think Proverbs was actually collected together, these different sayings, a lot from Solomon, other places, to give the young people who were going to be leaders in the nation of Israel a handbook. And it was all men at the time. So if you read it and you realize like that focus, think of it as if you're giving a young man who is going to be a leader a guidebook of wisdom. That's what you'd find in Proverbs. So maybe you're a leader and you work somewhere, you teach somewhere, you do something with other people, and we're talking about this one act of love. This is how it was suggested in those settings. Never walk away from someone who deserves help. Your hand is God's hand for that person. Don't tell your neighbor maybe some other time or try me tomorrow. And he goes on, and the author's just saying, when you have what somebody needs, be free with it. Share it. Give it to them. Help someone out. Love is just doing the thing that the other person needs, no matter how it feels. What is the act of love? This is your assignment for the week. What is the act of love that the person you call your one would benefit from? That's your homework. Just one act at a time. And then when that one's done, what's the next one? You do it again. What would benefit the other person? No matter how it makes me feel. Maybe like I find myself often, we talk about the one and you're like, "All my friends are Christians, Chris." And that's typically the case. So we've done some things and created some opportunities. 928 Central is the one that comes to my mind the strongest in this part of our conversation, because it's a platform for us who are 99, people who are already connected, who want to serve and find new ones in our community. 928 Central is a separate organization that we started that serves the nonprofit community of Northern Arizona. And it's a place for us to connect. And the thing that I love about 928 Central, here are just a couple pictures of what we've been talking about in our strategies, the things that I experienced from Todd and Anita all those years ago. They're the same things we do collectively through an organization called 928 Central. We have meals together. That's a luncheon where about 30 or so nonprofit leaders from our community gathered together. On the right is Cynthia, who leads 928 Central. Her friend Kathy, who's a part of our church, who volunteered to organize and lead a golf tournament. We said do one party at a time, and if you've ever been to a golf tournament, that's pretty close to a party. Right, for a good cause. They helped Sunshine Rescue Mission raise a ton of money. We just have a platform where, as an organization, we're doing the same things I'm asking each of us to do individually. You just see a little bit over there on the right, they're having a meal together. That's Cynthia with a couple folks. They're not a part of our church. They're just a part of our community. And they care about people. And we care about them with conversations and meals and words and acts of love. The intention was that we'd create proximity. Proximity between people of faith and people who serve others. And you go, hey, I need to interact with more ones. It's maybe there's a place in 928 Central that could connect, you could be a part of. Email Cynthia. Talk to somebody at the New Here tent. What act of love can you do this week? You can do it in the next couple days. How could being involved in 928 Central, just learning more about a place, a role you could play, help you engage with our community more? Here's the last thing I want to talk about today. Is we've developed a tool to help you and to help me with our ones. Because of what I know is when we talk about this idea of reaching others and sharing the gospel and all the things we've been talking about, we talk about this often. It feels very daunting and overwhelming. And how am I going to do this all by myself? Is often the question I hear. I don't want you to, I mean, you can do it by yourself, but we want to do it together. As a church, we want to partner with you in this. Not just tell you to go do it, but help you have resources to do it and encouragement and the things you need, the things your one need. So the way that we can connect and we can partner together is through our app. And in our app, I want you to light your invite badge. And everybody in the room's like, what is that? Well, you don't know because it just started 2 days ago. So if you go to your app, I'm going to tell you what it is. It's awesome. And it's a tool where we partner together. So you go to your dashboard on the app, and you'll see, well, you won't see Hello Greg, but everybody, Hello Greg. You'll see a cross, and that cross probably is gray. It's not yellow, because when your badge is lit, it's yellow, and when it's not, it's gray. So yeah, any of those badges, what happens if you just touch it on your screen or you click on it on your computer, it brings up a box to describe it. And I want you to light your invite badge because on there, what I'm asking you to do is just tell us who your one is. So this is exactly what you're going to read. And then it says, who is your one? And then you click on that and you just answer a couple questions. And just tell us their name. We don't need any other information. We're not going to stalk them or market to them. None of that will happen. And you just tell us where you are in the 3Ds that I just showed you, that picture. Because we want to be engaged with this with you. I don't want to feel alone in reaching the people God has put in my life, and neither do you. And so when you do this, what it does is it lets us help you. It lets us know where you're at in this process, where is a church family, where most of us are, and then lets us know what are the resources that you need that we can help with. Because this is so important. This is our mission. One at a time. And we want to be engaged with you. We're not going to share it publicly. We're not posting this list anywhere. Like I said, we won't even have enough information on your one to connect with them. I don't want you to think anything weird's going on. Okay? But here's what I promise will happen. I will pray for you. Our leadership team, we will pray for you. We will pray for your one. And I will pray that wherever you are in this approach with your one, God will help you take the next step. He'll give you the discernment you need. He'll advance your one closer and closer to his son. That's what we're praying for. I can't wait to meet your one. And I won't tell him I've been praying for him. Okay? That'd be weird. I can't wait. Maybe it'll be the day they ask you to baptize them. Or that you've started looking at parts of the Bible together and learning. And Can you imagine how awesome that'll be? Because it'll be one word. Maybe it's one party that moves you forward, or one conversation, or the next meal, or maybe it's the next act of love. I don't know. But this is what God's calling us to do, and we want to do it together, because when I was my most far away and confused and struggling, Jesus came and embraced me. And every single time I push myself away from him, I make mistakes, he just hugs us. And he puts his cheek next to our cheek and he whispers in our ear, be clean. Because that's what he's done. And he wants us to be the conduit of telling the world that he's willing to make them clean one at a time. That's how he impacted people. And it's how he wants to use us to impact our community. Let's pray. God, we thank you that at some point in our life, when we needed to connect or reconnect with you, you put someone there to be your hands, to show us an act of love, to bring us to you so you could embrace us and tell us you're willing to make us clean and remind us of that incredible truth. God, we are surrounded by people who need to hear that message. Use our words, our conversations, our parties, our meals, and our acts of love to bring yourself closer to the people around us. God, this is, it's hard and it's challenging, but it's what you want. We pray for your help. We pray it in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Thanks for being here. God bless you. Let's go help one another follow Jesus.